Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.
Good morning. Welcome to Building Green. My name is Bill Vitale. I'm your host. This is the second part of a two-part program in which we're looking at getting to 100% clean energy in southeastern Pennsylvania. Last month, we sort of set the stage, talked about some of the bigger issues and the overriding philosophy of the Ready for 100 campaign. My guests today have returned. Jim Wylie, who's the chair of this year's club, I'm going to reintroduce them. Jim Wylie, to my far left, is the chair of the Sierra Club Southeastern Pennsylvania Group and the Ready for 100 team leader. He lives in Westchester, which is the county seat of Chester County. Bill Sabey is the Montgomery County Ready for 100 Montgomery County leader and is the chair of the Plymouth Township Environmental Advisory Board. And he lives in Plymouth Meeting, which is adjacent or near Norristown. And they're both active and ready for 100 in Montgomery County. Thanks for coming back.
Thank you,
sticking
Bill.
Around. We're going to move the discussion into the specifics. Although we wrapped up the first half hour with some discussion about the whole purchasing or producing purchasing power at a large scale. And I didn't know, and Jim, you seemed like you had some things you wanted to say about that. So, and it's germane, so, and we'll get into that maybe again in the program, but let's just start with that.
Okay. So in the summer of 2017, I believe it was, no, it was not long ago. It was in the spring of 2019, Philadelphia government, a government that has a great office of sustainability, and they really get it, and they have an energy office, and they have staff that do this for their day job, is figuring out how to transition the whole city of Philadelphia to 100% renewable energy. So step one is about getting the municipal buildings and facilities going in that direction. So they put out an RFP to solicit proposals for selling them solar power. And they got, the winning bid was from Community Energy in Radnor, and it's going to be a 70 megawatt solar, utility scale solar in Adams County, and the competitive rate is 4.4 cents per kilowatt hour, 4.4 cents per kilowatt hour for generation. And that includes the renewable energy credits. So Philadelphia then has those at their disposal. SEPTA put out a similar RFP, and they got like a 2.7 cents per kilowatt hour rate for a 50 megawatt system. But they kind of swap their renewable energy credits, so they don't own the SRECs. They just own some other Midwest wind RECs in the end. So that's a little behind the curtain info about that. But still, the point is, solar is clearly competitive with other things if you're a big user, or if you can aggregate a bunch of small users to have that kind of purchasing power and solicit those kinds of bids.
So SEPTA is going to generate the electricity they need for SEPTA. What the city is purchasing, is that for municipal
It's going to cover about 22% of the municipal buildings, so they have room to grow. So they can put out another bid, and if there's some newer technology or something better next year, so they really created a formula for the rest of us to follow on how to do this.
Yeah, that's pretty impressive. And 22%, that's a good chunk to start with. I can't imagine how many municipal buildings the city of Philadelphia has, but I'm sure
the airport.
So the airport's part of that, yeah.
The airport's owned by the city.
Wow, that's it's nice to get some positive good news.
Yes, definitely.
And we could see the trend. I mean, we're moving. That's the direction we're moving. When does that come online? It's not. up and running yet, right?
But no, they have to build it. I think it'll take a year to, to build it.
But it's happening. This is not in negotiation.
Contract signed.
Yeah, signed, yeah. Great. Okay, well, I think that's a good way to get us started. Let's maybe give us an overview of the, maybe this next slide would be helpful, of what is going on in Montgomery and surrounding the city and Montgomery and the surrounding counties. Can we bring up that next slide? That's it, great. One of you want to just kind of, we don't have to go through municipality, right. Maybe you could just talk in general.
So since the first resolutions were adopted in Chester County, Phoenixville and Westchester, Downingtown in the fall and winter of 2017, so in the last 2 years, we really made significant progress from that early start with just three in the first quarter that year. So then our team came on, Montgomery County's team started in November 2017. It took us about a year to a year and a half of promoting this among our different municipalities to before we got our first resolution adopted in November of 2018, and then an official Ready for 100 resolution in January of 2019. So since January 2019, the 11 commitments or 10 more commitments occurred between January and August. So we've hit this wave of adoptions as more and more communities find out about this. Jim wrote a nice little article on the domino effect that, you know, once we start, some neighbors then come online and say, hey, we want to do this also. So it's starting to catch on by word of mouth. But we're pretty proud that we've achieved 25 in a two-year period. And Philadelphia just came online late September, I believe.
Well, I don't know what's going on, but it sounds impressive to me. and each one of these is there a Sierra Club group that's at the core of it, or is this, or some are being done without kind of.
For the most part, it's a Ready for 100 campaign initiated.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I have been surprised. Hey, so and so just passed this resolution.
Yeah.
I didn't know anybody
was working there. Yeah.
But let me say this about the kind of secret sauce that's going on is that a lot of elected officials, borough councilors and township supervisors, they get it. They want to do something, but they don't know what to do.
Yeah.
How can a little township really take action to affect global climate change?
Yeah.
And so what we've provided is the resources, the kind of background information for how they can set goals and make a plan and hopefully do this aggregated buying for getting the ball started and showing people how they can really make a dent. And then there's the factor of the environmental committee. So why don't you talk about that?
Yeah, that's the other advantage we have in our area is that Pennsylvania actually has this advantage in that any community can have a volunteer environmental advisory council assigned, elected by the councils. So then these citizens meet monthly to help advise the community or the municipality on environmental factors. You know, a lot of them work on trees and water issues and trails and things like that. But this is a great opportunity to bring in the climate awareness and bring that to your municipality's attention. So we've been fortunate to be able to reach out to these environmental boards in each of our Montgomery County, Chester, Delaware County, and start the conversation there. And so a lot of the slides you're seeing are the kind of slides we use to help explain Ready for 100 to the environmental board. And then we enable and empower the environmental board to create their own version of that so that they can explain it to their supervisors or council members and then help to pitch the story for their local awareness. You know, there might be some really flooding issues that they could really focus on or heat effects that are going to affect a population.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they really want to tailor the conversation to really what will help that municipal government decide it's worthwhile doing. Plus, as Jim said, we've got a toolkit, we've got a process guide, we've got so many resources that we're sharing among each other that, you know, we're really allowing the environmental board and that municipality to kind of take this and run. They really won't have to do a lot of their own upfront work on this, you know, because we are sharing as we grow. We are learning from each other. We have monthly meetings and Ready for 100 teams get together. So we're just kind of increasing the knowledge all around our area for this and helping.
It all sounds really good. The experience here so far has been kind of the same, maybe not as well-oiled as what you guys are doing, but running for 100 went to the EAC. The EAC embraced it, was the in a sense the vehicle for presenting the resolution to City Council. And now it's kind of come back on the EAC, or one of its subcommittees, in a sense, has been charged of the expectation, both from Council and Reading for 100, that the EAC, the Environmental Advisory Commission, is going to move this process along beyond the resolution. One thing I did want to comment, and you kind of talked about empowerment, but I think what these campaigns and this approach to dealing with climate change, the climate crisis, it is empowering. You think about it at the global level, or even the national level, given the current state of things. It's like, well, what can I do? I can go out in the street, that doesn't do much. But both for elected officials and for residents and people who are concerned, it's incredibly empowering, because you can actually make some steps and accomplish something. So that sort of brings me to my next question. So resolutions, you've got resolutions in 25 communities. The next step, as I understand it, then is to, for each one of those municipalities that's passed the resolution, is to develop a clean energy plan as a way to move toward exactly what you're going to do. So where do things stand in terms of that next step? Have some municipalities moved beyond the resolution?
In the first year, our resolution actually sets a goal that in the first year after adoption of the resolution, we will create an energy transition plan for our community. It's kind of just written as it could be your environmental board, it could be citizen volunteers that pull it together, could be staff, township staff or borough staff that would work on it, or even hire an energy planner. So we've got a lot of options, but our goal is to try to pull together that plan the first year. So I'll let Jim talk about the Westchester approach.
So of the 25, there's probably 8 different strategies that are being for how to go about this.
Okay.
I think leading the way is the Westchester area. So in Westchester, there's, and I think you were going to ask me about this later, Bill.
Well, go ahead, jump in.
There's this thing called the Council of Governments that is kind of it's not really regional planning, but it's a regional entity that was able to issue a request for proposal for doing professional energy planning. So on behalf of 6 municipalities, not all of which have passed resolutions, 2 of the 6 passed resolutions, but on behalf of the whole region, those component municipalities said, yeah, count us in, we'll contribute to this effort, and let's do a regional plan. So it's like population of 100,000 people, greater Philadelphia area, about the size of the school district. We are developing a energy transition plan. I had hoped to be able to share that with you today, but the the current outlook is mid-January that we'll have
the plan.
In place to go start doing public meetings.
And so the when you say that the 6 municipalities, this is the governing body in those municipalities, not the EAC. It's actually the people in public office that have signed up. Is that
That's correct.
Yeah. And they've ponied up. They've
so the Council of Governments, which is kind of representative from each of those municipalities.
And that's an existing entity.
Actually created to make a public service television channel.
Oh.
But now they do the thing like shared fire departments and public
yeah,
water.
Yeah. So they do kind of cooperative body, maybe stuff
so
like that.
So they kind of had the authoritative entity to write an RFP on behalf of the multiple municipalities.
Oh, I see. So it's
initiative.
Actually have.
But then after we got actual proposal with a price tag, then we had to go to each municipality and say, can we please have a few dollars to contribute to this? And they all stepped up to the plate to do that. The total bill was about $75,000 to do this.
And that's the one that the Cadmus Group has done.
That's correct.
Is that right? Okay. Mm-hmm. And so they prepared that. And was that experience a good experience to have used this consultant and have a consultant prepare it? What's your, I don't know if he's on screen, he is. as I said before the show, you don't have to answer every question I ask.
Right, so we'll see what happens in the end. Since our advisory group, I think it's been a great process, and I encourage other people to follow the process. But I haven't seen from the notes we've got back. I want to really pushing back to make sure it's the quality and has the answers in it that we want.
Yeah.
So our advisor group has some chops about what about renewable energy. So we're kind of pushing back and say, hey, we can do better here and here. So that's why things have slipped a bit. Mm-hmm. We're trying to hold them to the standards of our contract, and we'll see if we get what we want in January.
Yeah. So I don't know that the viewers really want to get into the weeds on this, but I think that's a conversation I would love to have with both of you, or especially with you, because we're facing that. You know, how does this get done? Who does the plan? And
sure, but I think we should talk about the other formulas.
Okay, that'd be great.
So we realized that Chester County was, Westchester was starting off with a request for a proposal, got the energy planner hired. Meantime, Montgomery County is realizing, hey, we've got our goal to start creating our energy transition plans. A lot of ours are due by April this year for Earth Day. So many of our communities started to just start writing their own outlines of a transition plan. So Cheltenham has made the most progress. They've created a document outline, and we're starting to helping fill in different sections. So hopefully by the time the CADMIS report comes out and we have the Cheltenham plan fleshed out, let's say by February, we would have then something to look at and take the best of each and try to come up with a master template that maybe we could use across all of Southeast PA, have each municipality then be able to tailor it for what's more unique per their needs. You know, are they more rural? Are they more city-centric, village-centric? So I think we're going to really benefit from both this, having the energy transition planner and CADMIS, and then our own volunteer labor, and use our own knowledge to try to help weave this together into a really effective outline of a plan.
So if I'm clear, what in Montgomery you're doing it without a consultant.
Right
but
now.
But you'll be turning to maybe some of the things that the consultant
we're hope for. Now, we did get to the point where during the fall we realized we might like to follow the path of hiring an energy planner. So we asked our municipalities to put some money into their 2020 budget. So I'd say there are at least four or five out of the 11, they were able to get some money in their 2020 budget. So we're going to look at the results from what we get from CADMIS as well as the volunteer developed plan. And then if we're missing some elements, then those communities that have money could then say, let's hire an energy planner to help us fill in the gap.
Okay.
That's what our hope is.
So the takeaway is that there's more than one way to go at this, and it's still being sorted out.
The Phoenixville region are doing doing it in the context of their comprehensive plan.
Uh-huh.
So they're kind of more of a sustainability and context. Radnor is doing it on their own. So they're single township. They don't really like their neighbors. So they're doing it on their own.
Uh-huh.
And a couple other townships are kind of waiting to see what's going to come out of both Westchester and Montgomery County and Cheltenham.
And we have a couple boroughs. Norristown and Bridgeport actually don't have an environmental board, so they really didn't have a volunteer staff to help them or a Ready 400 volunteer necessarily. So they're kind of hopeful to see what comes out of the rest of us and then maybe benefit from using that on their own since they don't have a lot of staff. The other thing is that I think we'd want to encourage anyone starting this process in their area to look at their county to see what kind of planning assistance they might get. You know, we've started to tap into Montgomery County planning. Delco is just starting to have initial conversations. I know Jim's talked to Chesco planning a little bit, but, you know, that could be another level of assistance to see if we can get some more master planning around all of us.
Yeah, my one tip there is don't take no for an answer.
Keep being persistent.
Be persistent.
Okay. Well, yeah, you know, I mean, we've got the, and I hate to use this analogy, but in some ways we've got the wind behind our backs.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Well, because, yeah, just the argument gets easier to make every day because the crisis gets more visible and the cost becomes less of a challenge, I think. That's my sense. Okay. I guess the next question I had was, how are the campaigns organized? I think you guys have touched on that, so.
Well, I'll just quickly say that we're organized by county, but our targets are the individual municipalities. Pennsylvania has so many smaller municipalities. Unless you have a big town like Reading or Philadelphia, you need to organize bigger.
No, we've got way too many. There was a big push in Berks County to try and have municipalities merge with a mixture of success, because I think two or three did. Because it's just duplication of so much stuff. We've got about 8 minutes. One of the questions that you had suggested was how the different environmental groups have set a variety of goals. Some are saying 100% renewable energy, 80 by 50. I guess that's like 80% by 2050, I'm assuming. I don't know if one of you want to just say something about that and why. Your approach, our approach is 100% renewable energy. I mean, it makes sense to me.
Sure, they're all compatible, right? 80% greenhouse gas reductions by 2050 is more of a greenhouse gas climate change vision thing. Carbon neutral, obviously, is about carbon footprint. So 100% renewable energy is kind of like common ground, right? And it's also a really big piece of the problem is the source of our energy, all right? So nobody's saying it's our whole problem, but it's common ground. People that are interested in reducing pollution can get behind renewable energy. People that are interested in improving our energy security can get behind renewable energy. Getting off the grid, stop paying the man, and get solar panels on their house. They can advocate for renewable energy. So it brings a lot of factions together. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You want to say anything?
And it's distributed generation. The more we get solar farms in our local area, there's less risk of the grid being impacted for the wider region. We get one of these monster storms, it could take out the grid of the whole East Coast. So if we can get this local generation, do microgrids in cities even companies, there's proposals to help a company who has a campus of buildings, create their own microgrid and have electric vehicle generation, so you have some battery backup and things like that. So you take the best of balancing your generation with your use and off use. So I think there's a lot of good strategies coming out of this that are really going to help a community feel they can really implement this.
Yeah, we've been focusing mostly on, focused mostly on the generation. Maybe not enough on the grid. I did a program on the grid, and I had somebody from PMJ here who knew that they existed, number one. The grid, and then, I read a couple of books in the last few years. I mean, the grid is another piece to this, and this does help. It helps build in that resiliency if you have a smart grid and you can produce scattered sites, so to speak, you become less vulnerable than the that major blackout that knocked out, I guess, 5 states it was just a miscalculation in one spot in Ohio that sent the whole.
I visited a residence that we had a solar home tour here in October in the region, and I went to a resident in Delaware County, and he had solar PV on his roof, of course, and then he had purchased one of those Tesla battery walls, and then he had that as backup because he has had grid outages where he's had to have a power generator, and if that takes more than 3 days and you run out of fuel or whatever, he found that this would be a backup. So he's able to put most of his house circuits on the battery backup so that he has that protection for any outages.
And that's the reality. Okay, so Let's talk about some of the obstacles you've faced. I mean, what's been the reception or opposition from elected officials, the communities you've spoken to, the public, businesses, business sector? Do you want to address that?
I'll quickly say it's been substantially positive with a caveat. I'm with you 100%. What's it going to cost? So until the rubber meets the road, we find out what it's going to, the delta cost is going to be, then we'll find out who's really behind it. But we keep putting up examples of like the Philadelphia Power Purchase Agreement or community solar in other states that is selling 10% below market value. We keep doing this in the aggregated buying examples, and we'll get people behind us.
Bill, you want to add anything?
Yeah, we're looking at, now that we've got enough of our communities working together, now if we can do that aggregated, pull all our demand together, could we create a power purchase agreement amongst all of those communities? It doesn't have to just be one. We could take part ownership in that.
Uh-huh.
So that would be really an advantage that would then save each of those communities their own money for energy. So if you can lock in 4.4 cents a kilowatt hour for 20 years, and you don't know yet what the natural gas electricity cost is going to be. Right now it's very low because there's so much extra capacity.
Yeah. Yeah.
But what if the demand or the supply starts to, demand around the world goes up, the cost is going to go back up.
Right. I did real quickly, we're not 2 minutes, but I did want to ask when you mentioned about the Adams County installation, it's going to be 4.4 cents per kilowatt for generation. Now I know at my house, we're buying wind energy, and I think we're paying 11 cents a kilowatt. But those aren't comparable numbers.
Oh, right? Yes, that's, they are.
It is.
Yep.
So that 4.4 cents is the cost to the city of Philadelphia.
If you used 100 times more than you'd get a better
rate. We could get that. Right, we'd get a better rate.
Right.
So,
and that's generation. So your 11 cents is probably the extra transmission.
No. 11 cents, I'm sure, is generation.
Is that your price to compare?
I think it is. Oh, yeah. Our electricity bill. I mean, if we don't use any electricity, our bill is $50 a month. I mean, they've got it set up so that, efficiency works in their favor. So do you know, what Philadelphia is paying now for its electricity? Is it?
Yeah, it's like 4.3 or 4.5.
Okay, so it's competitive to the rate they're paying.
Very competitive.
I'm sorry, even though we extended this to an hour, we've got 1 minute left. So what? We had a couple other questions. What's compelling that you want to get in this last minute?
I wanted to get to your point about what Berks County should be doing, right?
Okay.
And I will say community engagement, right?
Okay.
There are get out there, get in people's faces. Examples that we had in Chester County with a solar tour, with energy expos. And last Friday we had a march at the Christmas parade. We all wear these great 100% hats.
That's great.
Yeah, so we had 50 people with these hats on at the Christmas parade.
Carrying signs for each of our municipalities was a solar panel on the back. We had a sun and three windmills and three electric cars.
Great.
It was a great parade.
Was the response good, too, for
it was
people in the crowd?
Good sharing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Renewable energy, go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I can tell, part of this is having fun and maintaining a positive attitude. Anything else? I mean, we could squeeze in a second or two here.
Go ahead.
Okay. Thanks again for coming up and participating. We're taping this in the studio, and it's a really nasty day out there today, so thanks for coming. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you next month.
Thank you, Bill.
Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.